Chief Operating Officer for the National Gaucher Foundation, and we are thrilled to welcome each and every one of you, not only here physically. We are hoping that we are now live streaming on Facebook, but it is possible that we are just going to be recording it and posting it later so that we have a broader audience to be able to reach for those who were not able to be here in person. So I just wanted to take a few minutes to open this meeting here in California. The piece of music that you were just listening to was composed by Carol Lees. She was an inspirational woman known very well in the Gaucher community. On December 7th, 2016, Carol passed away. On behalf of the NGF, I'd like to take a few moments to pay tribute to her. Carol was diagnosed with Gaucher at the age of 19, and she suffered immensely for another 21 years until enzyme replacement therapy was available. Though ERT provided some relief, Gaucher caused irreparable devastation to her body over the 40 years prior to her receiving treatment. For the past 47 years, she had the love and support of her husband, Richard, by her side. Carol was involved with the NGF from the beginning, and she was a gentle force who encouraged the development of more programming to benefit patients and experiments in weightlessness. And the song itself is entitled Sea of Tranquility. It was one of hers and Richard's favorites, the sea representing Carol. The tranquility is now where Richard says he likes to think of her as existing now. Through all the years of living with Gaucher, she read and explored intensely to find a path that might explain the pain, from science to religion, from literature to poetry. And the more she explored, the more she believed that the universe is ordered harmonically, and that her connection to the harmony, the music, was her only way to be free of the pain. And despite the pain that she experienced, she composed. She was one of the early female composers creating music for theater and films, classical and rock and roll, and finally electronically, which is what the album Experiments in Weightlessness was composed of, with her writing and playing all the parts and the sounds that went into recording it. Richard shared with me that he likes to think of her as having made it to the weightlessness in the universe, which she believed to be ordered harmonically as she aspired. The world is a better place because of Carol's existence, and her tremendous talent, humor, and grace will be sorely missed. She is survived by her husband, Richard Lees, her sister, Nancy Kolodny, and her niece, Laura Garrett. I'd like to direct your attention. We have a video for you all to be able to view.
Diagnosed when I was very young, and my parents were told that I was going to die.
Well, first they thought it might be leukemia, and then they came out and said it's Gaucher's disease. Well, I'd never heard of that.
Gaucher disease is an inherited disorder, often having crippling bone disease, enormous livers and spleens, frequent bleeds, bruises, fractures of their bones.
It's like your bones are screaming.
Brian was really getting sick fast. NIH was ready to do an experiment, and Brian was the one the experiment was done on.
So he got the injection, and in 1 week, it was almost beyond astounding.
Brian was the first patient to actually receive enzyme replacement therapy.
It changed everything. You have this treatment, but you have most of the people with Gaucher's disease don't even know it.
It is very common. It's the most common Jewish genetic disease.
1 in 10 Jews of Eastern European descent are a carrier for Gaucher's disease.
And one of our goals in the National Gaucher Foundation is to really try and address this unmet need so that patients are diagnosed promptly and then they receive the appropriate treatment.
This is a serious disorder, but it's treatable. Hi everyone, my name is Brian Berman, as you just heard. And I just want to begin by saying welcome and thank you. The topic of my remarks for tonight is the National Gaucher Foundation, the past, the present, and the future. But it's important to understand a little bit more about my personal story to see how that informed where we are today and where we're going. Because the reality is the last place on earth I ever expected myself to be was the CEO and president of the National Gaucher Foundation. During my teenage years and my early 20s, I didn't really even want to hear the word Gaucher anymore. In fact, I didn't want to have anything to do with anything medical whatsoever. I had felt at that point in my life that I had lost my youth to Gaucher disease. There was, of course, the medical issues that were talked about in the film. Lots of pain, immense pain, bone pain, bruising, bleeding, painful procedures. I think the worst one being multiple bone marrow biopsies. It's funny, to this day, and I say this all the time, but it still amazes me. My peers, my friends, they look at me wild-eyed when I tell them about how many medical procedures I've had. And I'm always amazed that they have never experienced something like an MRI. I feel like I've lived in an MRI. But perhaps worse than the physical issues were the psychological issues. Being bullied, feeling different, being excluded. I couldn't play sports for so long that by the time I was strong enough to, no one wanted me on their team. And so this was really difficult for a kid growing up. I was hot-tempered and didn't love the idea of continuing anything having to do with medical. That's not to say I had a bad childhood. I think that's not true at all. It's the opposite. I had an incredibly loving family. And I had some pretty amazing and unusual experiences. My parents and aunt and uncle formed the National Gaucher Foundation with the goal of finding a treatment for type 1 and supporting the development and the commercial availability of it. And I was kind of the mascot. So I was told I was the first in the world. I was made to feel very special. I spoke in front of Congress. I appeared on live television on the home show, and I was partook in medical journals and documentaries. But the fact is that Gaucher was kind of all-consuming. I mean, even when we traveled, when we could travel, I needed constant care. Oxygen, we had to find infusion centers where, amazingly, no one knew how to start an IV on a little child. My personal record was being a pincushion where a doctor missed 17 times before getting a vein. So obviously, I became very attached to my parents, and I was an excellent student. That was the only thing that I could do really well, and so I focused on it. And I wanted very badly to be normal, and I think that a lot of people can relate to that. I actually learned to self-infuse. Becoming independent and self-infusing was very important to me, and I began university. I wanted to be normal, except the reality is that I wasn't normal. During my early years of university, I went through three major surgeries. I had emergency gallbladder removal. I had removal of a tumor the size of a racquetball from my leg. I had complications from a wisdom tooth extraction. The wound wouldn't heal, and more importantly, I had debilitating joint pain and fatigue and lots of immune issues. So after all these surgeries, I was once again committed. I'm gonna put all this behind me. I'm done with medical. I wanna be normal. But once again, unfortunately, I wasn't normal. I would sometimes wake up in so much pain that I would have to crawl to the bathroom. My body simply couldn't support the weight on my joints, and I had regular fatigue. But I refused to deal with it. I decided to stick my head in the sand and ignore these symptoms because I was so focused on putting Gaucher behind me. Then something happened, something big happened in my life. During the winter break of my freshman year, I reconnected with my childhood sweetheart. And I've always been very, very driven. Growing up hearing that you were lucky to live and everything I had gone through, I realized that time was not something you wasted. So even though we were very young, we started talking about marriage. And then it dawned on me and I need to start thinking differently about my medical reality. I couldn't realistically get married and have a family and be crawling to the bathroom in pain. It's then that I connected with Dr. Mistry and decided to take a more proactive approach to my health. And little did I know it at the time, but the seeds for what would become the Optimal Health Initiative were born. We'll talk about that in a minute. Dr. Mistry impressed upon me how important it was to be tracking my physiological progress for my long-term quality and quantity of life. He identified all sorts of significant issues that were impacting my quality of life: osteopenia, persistent low platelets, vitamin deficiencies. My dose was way too low and it was dramatically changed. I started on supplements that I needed for calcium, D3, B12, and other deficiencies. I started seeing a primary care physician. It's kind of funny to think, but I mean, I was totally not even seeing a primary care. And I picked someone who knew that he knew nothing about Gaucher, so that he could view everything through the lens of Gaucher by working together with Dr. Mistry. And I started exercising. And my life changed dramatically. I started feeling much better. My numbers were improving. I was on the path to optimizing my personal health. I in fact, felt so dramatically better that I spoke with two siblings who also have Gaucher disease, and I recommended very strongly that they start seeing a specialist. And their experiences were similar, marked improvement in their quality of life. So this plan to sort of minimize Gaucher in my life was well underway now, but on a totally new proactive approach. Instead of burying my hand in the sand and ignoring things, I began taking meticulous records of all my medical history, following doctor's orders, so that I can minimize it by being more proactive about my health. That isn't to say during that time that I had no interaction at all with the Gaucher community. That's not true. When I was called upon, I was happy to speak with other patients and their family members, participate in educational videos, journals. I remember one time a particular filmmaker had a child that was diagnosed in his late teenage years, and his son refused to take treatment. He felt that it would make him too different. And it was kind of curious. The one thing I never resisted was taking treatment. I mean, that was something that I knew I had to do. And so he came to the house and spoke with me and recorded me taking my own infusion at home. And I remember another particularly startling interaction I had. I and one other patient were being interviewed, and she was diagnosed in her late teens, and of course I was diagnosed when I was 4. And they asked us about our experiences. And this person went first, and I was prepared to say what I normally said, which was, you know, it really was my parents who went through it. You know, I was the little child. For me, there were difficulties, but there were also amazing things, kind of what I just said to you. And I was really surprised to hear what this person said. Her deep sense of depression, she described scraping herself in the shower and how she felt that she couldn't get the dirty out of her blood. And I'm sitting there going, oh my God. You know, and I felt very happy and glad that I guess I was diagnosed so young, that it was a part of my reality from such a young age, that I never had those deep-seated negative psychological reflections on Gaucher until 2004. In 2004, my wife and I started a family, and when we were dating and we got engaged, we decided not to have her tested. Gaucher's was treatable, and if she was a carrier, so be it. If our kids had Gaucher, then pizza night would be pizza and enzyme night. My younger brothers who have Gaucher suffered much, much less because treatment was available for them immediately, and that's how I felt like it would be for my kids. I told myself I would be totally okay with it, and in my mind it was all made logical sense. Then when my wife was pregnant with our first, we decided that it would be smart to have her tested so that we could be prepared. And I have to say, that was one of the worst weeks of my life, waiting for the results to come back. For all my mental preparation, the idea that I could pass on a disease to my own children, the idea that they would have to endure what I went through, even though I knew that was irrational, it wasn't true, they were going to be able to get treatment if they had it, it was really overwhelming. And I think it speaks to the psychological impact that anyone who has a disorder has to deal with. Thank God it turns out she's not a carrier. And my kids have grown up hearing my story. They help with my infusions. My son Renan is such a pro at taping down the tubing, I really can't even do the shot anymore. I'm so used to him helping me. I can't do it without his help. I had a little funny aside once. We all know, those of us who are in ERT, that stuff is liquid gold. Once you mix it, you got to infuse it. And I had prepared my infusion, and then I realized I didn't have a tourniquet in the house. What was I gonna do? So I asked my eldest son, this just speaks to how comfortable they are. And my wife, by the way, when she first met me, would almost faint at the sight of blood. Well, that she moved through that real quick, being married to me. So my eldest son, I asked him to squeeze my arm as tight as he could, and voila, he was my human tourniquet, and it worked out great. So another thing that having children has done for me is to give me a much greater appreciation of what my parents went through. It's one thing to hear the stories about how they felt, to see it on the video, but having my own kids, I now really realize that I can't possibly comprehend how difficult that time must have been for them. And I appreciate them ever more. My wife and I talk a lot about not wasting time and not taking for granted all the blessings we have. We talked about a Gaucher patient who I knew growing up, who was born just 5 years earlier, didn't have access to treatment, and in time didn't survive. I attended his funeral. That was very difficult. As our family grew, I was working in the family business and I was feeling better. I was very busy and I was taking this proactive approach to my medical reality. And it was allowing me to live a much higher quality of life and achieve the normal or as close to it as possible that I had been longing for. And then again, everything changed in 2011. You see, the NGF, this is the part about the past, the NGF had really achieved its initial mission to support the development of a treatment for type 1. The mission changed to support the type 1 community, and the biggest program by far was called, and is still called today, the CARE program, a program that provides enormous financial assistance to Gaucher community members in need, and it pays for primarily insurance premiums. NGF also has a modest budget for education and awareness, but CARE really defined the NGF both in budget and in impact. The sole manufacturer of the treatment at the time was generously supporting these programs for the community. Then, as I said, everything changed when there was a catastrophe in the manufacturing facility, and this catastrophe led to a cascade of events. First of all, there were patients without medicine. Second of all, there was chaos in the community, uncertainty, fear. Third, there was a fast tracking of another similar medicine through the FDA, which then led to a struggle for market share. And fourth, this led to the risk of funding of CARE and NGF's other programs being cut because no longer was there one player. So I was asked by Rhonda Byers, NGF's leader for over two decades, to get involved and help negotiate between the pharmaceutical companies to secure funding for the CARE for our community. What could I possibly say? Of course I said yes. I got involved, but the yes was, okay, just this once. I'm on cruise control now. It was a tricky situation, but ultimately we were successful, and I felt like, okay, I can get back to my normal. But not too long after that, Rhonda kind of dropped a bombshell that she wanted to retire, and she told me that she wanted me to succeed her. She didn't really feel that the organization could remain viable in this new world of multiple competing pharmaceutical companies unless I agreed to take the helm. This was a really, really big decision for me. It was a really hard decision. And after much soul searching, I decided it was the right thing to do. And in January of 2016, I took the reins. But the question was, what would the NGF look like going forward? So my first thoughts were threefold. Number one, the NGF was really the CARE program. CARE was critical. It's where most of our resources go. It's where we're needed. Number two, we needed to support the community in other ways. But I didn't really know, and we didn't really know what that meant exactly. We had a nice social media presence, we had a large Yahoo group and a massive database of people, but we had some canceled patient meetings. What did people really want from the NGF now? And number three, as far as education and awareness was concerned, I saw the value of having a great website, a place where people looking could find information. But honestly, as far as proactive education and awareness, at that time, I thought it was a total waste of time for two main reasons. Number one, it had been 30 years since the medical breakthrough. Surely everyone in the world knew about Gaucher disease. And more importantly, the pharmaceutical companies have all the money in the world. They're the ones who have the incentive to educate so people will buy their products. In fact, they're so good at marketing, I actually have copies of two amazing colored children's books in my library at home. This country has 350 million people in it. How the heck could we reach anyone on a shoestring budget? And why should we really try? We should focus on things that the pharmaceutical companies can't do and not compete with them on things that they can do and have way more resources than us. So those are my hypotheses going in. One of the first things we did was to take a survey of our community. We have a very large database, as I said. And after that, we met with stakeholders and attended relevant conferences. And what we learned through that effort would shape the future of NGF, where we are today and where we're headed. Specifically, three things stood out. Number one, a lot of people in our community responded. They were only given a very short period of time to respond to a pretty thorough survey, and a lot of them did. Our community wants to be engaged. Secondly, and amazingly, most patients who responded were not being seen by a Gaucher specialist, kind of like my situation prior to my epiphany that I needed to do something about my life. And also, there was a significant number of people that actually weren't being treated at all. Finally, and this was the most shocking by far, the average diagnosis period for a new Gaucher patient was absurdly long. From the time they suffered enough to seek medical help until the Gaucher's was diagnosed was on average over 5 years. I was flabbergasted. I mean, frankly, what it meant to me was that all the proactive education and awareness efforts to date were, to put it mildly, kind of a dismal failure. So the mission of the NGF began to crystallize. And everything that we do today and everything that we do going forward falls under two main objectives. Objective number one, to help maximize the quality of life of the type 1 patient community. In addition to expanding care and Care Plus, which pays for additional expenses such as travel and supplies, we are working on creating the Care More program, which will provide aid to pay for insurance deductibles. This hopefully will come online by the end of the year. We're currently in the process of getting OIG approval. And as I mentioned earlier, we have launched the Optimal Health Initiative. The primary objective of the Optimal Health Initiative is very, very simple. Encourage Gaucher patients to seek specialists who can properly track and advise them regarding Gaucher and remove any barriers that may be there to making this happen. The secondary objective of the OHI, Optimal Health Initiative, is for our advisors, one of which is here tonight, Samantha. I hope you all get a chance to meet her, to get to know each patient on an individual level so we can start to learn what additional services we can provide. What do people want? Whether that means mentorship, patient meetings, webinars, or other educational pieces. We want to learn what folks need. The second objective of the NGF now is to reduce the diagnosis time for Gaucher type 1. How do we do this? This is a massive undertaking. So the first thing we've done is to totally revamp our website. And in the 4 months that we've been live, we've had over 200,000 hits and a 300% increase in website activity. We're very, very active on social media. We're rolling out online advertising, print advertising, human interest stories, and perhaps our most powerful tool, viral videos. The first viral video was my story. To date, it has over 1,800,000 unique views, and unique views means a person who clicks and watches it twice doesn't count towards that number. And in addition to that, we've teamed up with J Street and Emory University to create a program to provide no-cost genetic testing based on a saliva sample. We produced another video called Spit Happens, and we've been running that campaign for a number of months, and it's been very successful. We're also targeting, because we have a limited budget, very specific segments within the society and specific geographies where Gaucher is more prevalent. We've also hired a medical liaison who is working with the medical community to expand the awareness of Gaucher disease. We're reaching out to prominent figures who have had Gaucher touch their lives to help support us in these efforts. Something amazing I learned earlier this year was that while cystic fibrosis is more present than Gaucher, it is still an orphan disease. And yet everybody knows CF and the CF Foundation. My goal is that everyone should know Gaucher. Before I conclude, I want to say two more things, and then I'll take some questions if anyone has any. The first thing is that I want to talk about Gaucher type 2 and type 3. This is a devastating form of the disease, much rarer in the US, and for which there is really no viable treatment yet. It is fatal. When I started at the beginning of this year, I spoke with a woman who heads a foundation for type 2 and 3. She lost her daughter to this. Understandably, this community wants help. It needs help. Unfortunately, the help it really needs is the area of research, and research is enormously expensive, and we don't currently have the resources for that. What we discussed was the hope that if we are successful in getting type 1 on the map, then perhaps the NGF could grow to the point where one day it has the resources to provide research grants. In the meantime, all of our programs are open to type 2 and type 3 patients. In addition, we're trying to be very sensitive when executing our education and awareness to clarify that we're always talking about type 1. Finally, I want to personally express my gratitude to Dr. Mistry for taking his time to come and speak. It was wonderful hearing him in New York. And I want to thank also Amy Blum and Samantha and all the rest of our team members for all the great work that they do. Thank you. If there are any questions for me, I'd be happy to answer. Otherwise, we'll have Dr. Mistry present. Yes. So it's a great question, and it's hugely important. It's probably, aside from folks who suffered for a long time, it's probably the single biggest psychological worry that I deal with. And it's something that I think every Gaucher patient at some point reckons with. And so to answer your question, the NGF doesn't have an arm that's dealing with that right now. We're relying heavily on the pharmaceutical companies who have very high incentive to make sure that this continues and to provide programming if, God forbid, the pre-existing condition limitation were to be put back on or insurance caps were to be put back on, which, by the way, I hit, you know, being one of the earliest, I hit my caps. And so they have programs. It doesn't really make us feel any easy, you know, doesn't put us at ease, but they have teams and teams of people that are working on this, and so we're really relying on their efforts. If we had more resources, perhaps we could kind of engage that battle as well, but really we're trying to focus in on doing what we think we can have the biggest impact on. Sure. So.
Are there ways that patients can get involved with the pharmaceutical companies or contact people that maybe you can share with some of us so that we can share our stories?
Sure. You know, I don't know the answer to that question. I think that what would be good is if we communicate, the patients together communicate maybe with the different stakeholders. I know the pharmaceutical companies are definitely interested in this topic, and maybe get some advice from experts on lobbying and experts on how these sort of things play out as to what we can do as a consolidated group. That's a really good point. I think it should be a follow-up, Amy, for after the meeting. Anybody else? Okay, with that, oh, sorry, one more.
I'm Chet Whitley, and I think it's just wonderful you all are here and talking, and I'm the course director for the World Symposium meeting this week, and I just wanna say thank you for coming. A couple of highlights, NGF facilitated getting this lysosomal disease review book put together. And in case people didn't know, it arrived. There's this big, huge palette full of books. And so those who are attending Lysosomal Disease Network will see this great production, actually. It's just amazing, this book. Also, those of you who are sticking around tomorrow, you're welcome to come to the COPA workshop, Council of Patient Advocate People. And everybody's welcome. It's free. 8 o'clock. Nine o'clock, I guess. And it's another way in which you can interact with research on lysosomal diseases. We're planning our next NIH application for funding of the Lysosomal Disease Network, and I'd love to see you play a role.
Thank you. And with that, I'd like to welcome Dr. Pramod Mistry.
Thanks very much, Brian. Really, I want to thank Amy Blum and the NGF team to organize this meeting. and give me an opportunity to talk about a vision that really came out of the time that I looked after Brian and the vision of Optimal Health Initiative was really born at that time. And so I think this has really become a passion for us at Yale. How can we develop personalized care, emphasizing patient-reported outcomes? Because if your platelet count goes up by 10 points, doesn't make you feel better. We want to know about what is the impact on your functioning, quantity of life, as Brian very nicely described, and real outcomes in terms of relief of pain and so on. So that's what I'm going to be talking about today. First, I want to thank our sponsors for the meeting today. And that's, of course, National Gaucher Foundation under inspiring leadership of Brian and his new team. And Pfizer, Shire, and Sanofi Genzyme have also very kindly supported today's event, including the live streaming via the Facebook. And so in 2017, we have a lot of new updates to give you. And there are now transformative therapies for Gaucher disease. The enzyme replacement therapy, we are in a wonderful situation that we've got three very safe and effective enzyme replacement therapies, Cerezyme, Viprev, and Eliliso, and we now have an effective and well-tolerated oral substrate reduction therapy, Sadelga or Eliglustat. And I'm going to develop the theme, the vision that Brian outlined of personalized monitoring. Because I'm sure you become aware over time that Gaucher disease is so different from one person to another. Even within one families with multiple affected individuals, the disease can affect a different person in a very individualized manner. And therefore, we have to have an individualized plan for monitoring the patient and treating them to get the best outcome. And I think that Brian and his team have done a wonderful job of empowering the patient and really launching a new era in the history of Gaucher disease under Brian's able leadership. I'm really very proud that Dr. Ellen Sidransky is here, who has been a real pioneer in how this rare disease can impact common diseases and even illuminate mechanisms in common diseases such as Parkinson's disease and myeloma and cancer. I'm going to end a little bit with a topic that is now acquiring a lot of importance about why is Gaucher disease so variable. And we must not forget patients with type 2 and type 3 disease. They are not the orphans of the Gaucher disease community. We are absolutely committed to advocating for them, researching with on their behalf, and developing new treatment options for this group of patients who have the most devastating form of type 3 Gaucher disease. And so the quest to develop the transformative therapies really began half a century ago this month with Dr. Brady on the one hand on the East Coast and Dr. Ernie Beutler at the Scripps Clinic. And this is Dr. Brady receiving the National Medal of Science from President Bush for his enormous contributions in the field. And really it was his work that led to the development of an entirely new specialty of lysosomal diseases. And today, this week's conference in San Diego is really an outcome of a lifetime of his work with multiple therapies for different lysosomal diseases and where we are in the field of Gaucher disease. We rest on the shoulders of giants. We are here today because of these giants in medicine, and Dr. Ernie Beutler here at the Scripps Clinic made enormous contributions to the field. A pioneering scientist clone the gene for Gaucher disease, made seminal contributions not only to development of enzyme replacement therapy for many, but many other hematological diseases, was the president of the American Society of Hematology. So, Gaucher disease is a really research-driven specialty, and something that for me, everything begins with a patient. Almost every research question that I've asked has begun with an evaluation for a patient like Brian. In fact, when Brian first presented to me, he was, I think, barely 20 years old, and he had had a devastating illness from gallbladder surgery. He was extremely sick, and that led to questions about how come gallstones are so common in Gaucher disease. And so every question that we've taken have arisen from caring for patients with Gaucher disease, and that have led to studies with the registries, collaborations, and then development of the mouse model. And these models have informed questions about patient care and mechanisms of the disease. And so Gaucher, and not only that, we are now realizing that Gaucher disease is beginning to inform cancers, particularly multiple myeloma and Parkinson's disease. And this have again come through pioneering work from Dr. Sidransky's group. And I think one of the most memorable sentences that I've learned from her work, a large body of work on this, is that this development came about because of astute observation by clinicians caring for patients with Gaucher disease and then following it up with rigorous research. And so taking care of patients with Gaucher disease is a very high sense driven specialty. And what we strive for is how we can make our research meaningful in the clinic to take care of patients in order to try and ensure the best outcomes. And so this, we have today in the audience Eileen Silver. She was the editor of the Gaucher disease newsletter, I think around the time that this publication came about. This is in 1991, and it really illustrates the courage of the pioneering group of patients. And Brian mentioned Joey Newhouse, who passed away. And this is Joey seen here with Dr. John Barringer. This is Brian having his first infusion by Dr. Roscoe Brady. And what I find really moving and inspiring is that both Joey Newhouse and Brian went to the Congress to testify in front of the committee advocating for research in Gaucher disease. These young children with life-threatening diseases showing such extraordinary courage. I think this is a kind of immemorial documentation of the extraordinary story of Gaucher disease. And now hearing Brian as the CEO of the National Gaucher Foundation with his really quite bold and extraordinary vision, which is so characteristic, and it was evident even when he was a young child in front of the House of Representatives. All right, so in those days when Brian was sick, and this is Joey Newhouse here, is being seen by Barton here. I'm sorry, I might have gotten the name wrong. This is Norm Barton. In those days, there were all these challenges that the families experienced, and I think some of you here recognize it. There were long diagnostic delay. In fact, I was talking to Eileen, and she said it took almost a decade before the diagnosis was made. This is still a problem, including in Manhattan, New York. I've just looked after a family with young children having repeated bone crisis and were not diagnosed for several years. Patients had poor access to specialist physician. This is still a problem. Patients suffered from bone crisis, chronic disability. A meeting like this in those days, patients had a whole line of wheelchairs and walking aids lined up in the corner of the room. And now when we have meetings like this, patients are really healthy. Patients were in chronic pain. There was high rates of dependence on powerful painkillers. Patients had repeated hospitalizations for bone crisis, splenectomy, joint replacement surgeries, and patients died prematurely in that era from liver failure, infections, high pressure in the lung circulation, condition called pulmonary hypertension, multiple myeloma, lymphomas. And I think I was just so moved when Brian described this story about this young lady who was trying to wash this bad genes by developing this obsessive compulsive disorder of washing herself repeatedly because she felt that she had a bad set of genes. And this is still the case now. It's almost, you know, when patients come to the clinic, we talk about all the technology, biomarkers, but underneath that can be a great deal of pain. And it's something that I train my, teach my students and trainees, is that this is a source of poor quality of life and we should address it in a sensitive and respectful manner. Okay, in those days, patients had no treatment. And when the spleen got massive and the blood counts were low, the spleen was removed, and all that did was, after a temporary period of relief, patients developed more accelerated disease listed here. And so the prospect for patients with Gaucher disease were really terrible without having access to enzyme replacement therapy which came along. And so Brian was the first patient to have the infusions at the NIH under Dr. Brady. And this is Brian shown here with his brothers and his parents here. And, you know, he was the first person to receive the macrophage-targeted enzyme replacement therapy. And this is a procedure that we use to see the delivery of the enzyme. These are enzyme molecules being injected in the vein, and you can envision this. What happens when you're having your IV infusion of VPRIV or Cerezyme or Eliliso? And within seconds, this is within 20 seconds, it's already in the liver and the spleen, and it's taken up at sites of disease activity in the bone marrow as well. And so the effects of this extraordinarily a powerful targeting to the cell type that builds up most of the lipid have been really quite dramatic. And the first generation enzyme replacement therapy were Cerezyme and Cerezyme, which made the treatment the standard of cure. And there are more than 5,000 patients that have been treated, and we have very long-term data. And the great thing is that we now have two new enzyme replacement therapies in the last 5 years, 6 years, in fact, and Eliliso and VPRIV, which are very similar to Cerezyme, and we are beginning to accumulate long-term data. And so we have safe and very effective enzyme replacement therapies, a choice of three different preparations, as shown here, and I think the attendees at this evening's meeting are on each of these different drugs, and I find that very encouraging. So we talked about the earlier era when life was so difficult for families that were affected with enzyme replacement therapy, and we now have 25 years. And in a study that we've just completed, we looked at the era and the evolution of what's happened to families affected with Gaucher disease. And we divided these eras into 5-year blocks, era 1, 2, 3, and 4, to see how new patients that are coming to the clinic have dramatically altered. And so what we read in the textbooks are often not representative of the new generation of patients. And what we learned from this study is that there is Brian mentioned the importance of increasing the rates of diagnosis so patients don't suffer from long periods of non-diagnosis. And this is a problem even in a sophisticated city like New York City, where children can come to great harm. And on average, I see one child from Boston or New York who has suffered from a bone crisis who have two copies of the N370S genes. And so I'm really pleased to see that the children who had long diagnostic delays, about 5 years in the first era, and now once the onset of symptoms occur, they are diagnosed early, and they also start enzyme replacement therapy in a timely manner. And when children are diagnosed generally in childhood, they tend to have much more worse disease. And we see this in younger adults as well as adults who are over 50 years old. And the new generation of patients have fewer surgeries to remove the spleen, and this is now performed very rarely. And the most dramatic effect, 20% of children in the first era had their spleens removed, and now it's almost unheard of in the children to have their spleens removed, and the rates are declining. So nowadays, to have the spleen removed in Gaucher disease is an extremely rare event. And that's a very positive outcome for the reasons that I mentioned, removal of the spleen was associated with accelerated disease in all the other parts of the body. The bone crisis and aspects of bone pain occur more severely in patients who have had their spleens removed. So these are splenectomized and non-splenectomized patients. So whether we look at bone crisis or bone pain or prevalence of avascular osteonecrosis or infarction, all of these are more common among patients who've had their spleens removed, and this is across all the age groups, pediatric, young adults, as well as adults over the age of 50 years. And the new generation of patients have fewer bone crises, so nearly a third of patients, children, in the first era had bone crises, and the new generation of patients is kind of rare event, and we are beginning to see this trend in the other group as well. Among the newly diagnosed patients. And so we now have three different enzyme replacement therapies that are all effective, and we also have a pill, substrate reduction therapy, and that works in a different way. Enzyme replacement therapy is just replacing the missing enzyme through your two-weekly infusion, and that it boosts the residual enzyme activity to normal. And so the normal physiology of the synthesis of the lipid that builds up in Gaucher disease and its degradation is restored. And when there is a deficiency of rates of production of the lipid, glucosylceramide, which is the substance that builds up in Gaucher disease, then that balances the small residual activity of the enzyme due to the mutations you have. So this is a concept called substrate reduction therapy, and it was developed by Dr. Norman Redding and Fran Platt at the University of Oxford in England. And this is work that started nearly a quarter of a century ago, and it has now turned into a reality with the recent clinical trials of Sodelga that is now been approved for type 1 Gaucher disease. And so simplistically put, in Gaucher disease, there is a low level of enzyme, and so this lipid builds up. And the idea with substrate reduction therapy is that it reduces the synthesis of this lipid, which is very important for the health of cells, is reduced to balance the low level of enzyme activity to restore the balance in the body. And this is the way mechanism by which substrate reduction therapy works. This has been subjected to a very exhaustive series of clinical trials over the last 10 years, some of which are listed here, and more than 400 patients in these clinical trials have been treated in the various studies in almost 26 centers in the world. And these are the long-term data of the clinical trial called the ENGAGE clinical trial. The initial clinical trial was just for 2 years, and now we have results going out to almost 5 years, and that shows reduction of spleen size, liver size, improvement of reversal of anemia, improvement of platelet counts, and these figures are very reminiscent to what one might see with enzyme replacement therapy, and so this has been very gratifying. Of course, with any new treatment, safety, short-term and long-term safety are very important criteria, and this has also been examined, and there are a number of other studies trying to compare whether it is similar to enzyme replacement therapy, and this is one such study showing that broadly the effects are very similar between enzyme replacement therapy and the oral substrate reduction therapy. The treatment has been very well tolerated, and these are the results from the clinical trial of one clinical trial that I had the privilege of leading, which is a comparison of in this clinical trial, 20 patients received Sodelga and 20 patients received placebo drug. And these are the side effects that they had, and they are broadly very similar. And in the real world, generally, these side effects have been noted, but it isn't as common, perhaps, as they have been noted even in the clinical trial. And so Gaucher disease, I think in this audience you don't need any introduction, but there has really been an explosion of new information in the research related to Gaucher disease. And what we have learned about Gaucher disease is that it's related to this enzyme deficiency, and it leads to this very obvious abnormality when we look at biopsies, and this is the Gaucher cell that is showing the cell that is engorged with the lipid that builds up in Gaucher. But the defect is in all cell types of the body, and this is the defect, a low level of enzyme, and it leads to buildup of this lipid shown here, GL1. The disease affects all organs in the body, and this is just for type 1 shown here, affecting the bones, the liver, the spleen, and anemia, and so on. Symptoms can begin at any age, from infancy to adulthood. Indeed, my oldest patient is a 100-year-old lady who lives in Brooklyn and who is not on treatment. She just has a slightly low platelet count. So the variability in the disease is really quite a remarkable feature, and I think investigators are now starting to really focus on why disease behaves so differently in different patients. And so one of the things we've learned is that there are different kind of lipids that build up in Gaucher disease. And this is a primary lipid that builds up. This is glucose and ceramide, glucosylceramide, otherwise known as GL1. But we've now learned that there are other lipids that build up because the cell is trying to find ways to get rid of this lipid. But in the process, it generates lipids like this called lyso-GL1 or glucosyl sphingosine. The problem is that these lipids are very toxic to cells, and it causes all kinds of other effects that is harmful for the patient. And so lyso-GL1, which has been investigated for decades by investigators, including the NIH and Sweden, at the NIH by Dr. Sidransky, has primarily been viewed as a lipid that was important for patients with neuropathic disease. But we are now beginning to learn that this may be very important for patients with type 1 Gaucher disease as well. So this downstream lipids are toxic to immune cells, to the bones, to the brain. The nice thing is that it can be measured in blood to track the status of Gaucher disease. And this is very, very rapidly becoming the marker, the standard biomarker, that may well replace the chitotriosidase that many of you have monitored regularly to see how your Gaucher disease is progressing. And there are some real challenges in the use of chitotriosidase in all of the patients. So we need a test like blood sugar for diabetics. And this comes the closest to that, checking the lyso-GL1. And I think in this year, we will see more application of this. And so the question is, Gaucher disease is a chronic inflammatory condition, and so all these lipids that I talked about are building up, and it causes chronic inflammation. And chronic inflammation is something that a lot of patients recognize, and when I talk to them, that they feel tired, their bones ache, they feel they have no energy. And the question is, how do these lipids that are building up lead to chronic inflammation? And this has been a focus of work in our laboratory and several other laboratories around the world. And what we have learned is that this lyso-GL1 that I talked about actually causes inflammation. So for many years, doctors have wondered, this is the MRI of a patient with Gaucher disease, and the spleen is huge. And in the days when the spleen was removed, the question that doctors asked was, how much of that huge spleen was the lipid? The big surprise was that it was less than 1%. And for many years, investigators have asked the question, so why is the spleen so big? And so we now know that there is a major inflammatory component in Gaucher disease. And so we've worked out one pathway, which is that these Gaucher lipids act as antigens that are presented by these macrophages and antigen-presenting cell to engage the whole of the immune system. The T lymphocytes, special kind of T lymphocytes that recognize lipid antigens, and as well as B lymphocytes, we produce antibodies that are directed to these lipids. And so, you know, this is very relevant, understanding the lipid that is, active in Gaucher disease, to understand other aspects of Gaucher disease as well. And so many of you have suffered from bone problems and osteoporosis, for example, and this is viewed traditionally as a balance between bone absorption and bone formation. And we have thought about increased bone absorption as a major contributor to osteoporosis and fragility fractures that are common in individuals who have this condition. And so some years ago, we did this study to look at whether it was the bone formation that was defective or whether it was the bone absorption. And I will not go into the details with this, but what we learned is that the bone formation in Gaucher disease was an important contributor to osteoporosis. So why is this important? This is important because bone formation is most important in children and young patients. So in normal, healthy individuals, we make a lot of bone and it reaches a peak bone mass as shown here. And then older adults gradually over time normally lose bone, and some of them end up with osteoporosis. What happens in Gaucher disease is that children and young individuals never achieve their peak bone mass, and so they enter adulthood with osteoporosis. What this means is that we want to, one of our goals in the clinic when we see children and young individuals in the clinic is to make sure that they are achieving a normal peak bone mass. So this is how, what we understand in the clinic and through the registries and so on can help us to improve, enhance our care of patients with Gaucher disease. And indeed, we saw that patients, children and young patients receiving enzyme therapy at young age, in children, older children, or young adults, have the most dramatic and impressive responses as far as bone density is concerned, and we don't see this so most strikingly in older patients. So one of our goals in the clinic is certainly to make sure that our children and young adults achieve peak bone mass, and it is one of our treatment goals. Okay, so I think that the slide ended up in the wrong place, so forgive me for that. And so now, managing Gaucher disease is a kind of a sophisticated business. We've got a very busy toolbox that is getting even more crowded. The role of the physician is becoming even more important, because I think we just don't do MRIs. We have to talk to the patients about the quality of life, their symptoms, examine the patients. I remember when I first came to Mount Sinai in New York, and I said, I want to examine your abdomen. The patients looked at me in consternation, because the standard procedure in the clinic is to just send everybody for an MRI. And so I think the physicianly role has become very important, and was underscored by what Dr. Sidrensky wrote in one of her papers, that this whole link with Parkinson's disease came about because of astute observations in the clinic by astute physicians. And then we've got all this technology, imaging, blood tests, biomarkers, genetics, and immune profiling. So how do we impact this in the care of individual patients? And so these are standard monitoring guidelines. I think a lot of you are familiar with this, so I will not dwell into this, but they are just routine battery of tests, including biomarkers and other tests increasingly being monitored to check a protein electrophoresis to screen for early precursors of multiple myeloma. And so this is a biomarker that we've been talking about, and I think this is going to become standard, I hope, in this year and coming years. And this is a biomarker that is massively elevated. Normal individuals don't have detectable level of this harmful lipid, but in patients with Gaucher disease, it can be massively elevated, and with enzyme treatment, it comes down so impressively. And one of our goals is to make sure that the levels are falling in the expected manner as shown here. Enzyme replacement therapy is very effective in lowering this biomarker, as is eliglustat, the substrate reduction therapy. So these are normal individuals who have no detectable level of this biomarker. These are untreated individuals, and patients receiving Sadelga over time, over two-year time period, have a very impressive reduction of glucosyl sphingosine in this biomarker. And so what are the unmet needs? And so Brian talked about his family, and this is his beautiful family. This is a picture that's now a few years old. This was with his brothers and parents. And what are the concerns? He looks very healthy. He's an entrepreneur, a leader. You would think that he's healthy. But I think that what is important when patients come to the clinic is that we have to have a short-range view and a long-range view. Someone in his mid-30s have every aspirations to live until he's 80 and see his grandchildren and so on. So what are the things that we should be looking out for? And so majority of the patients with enzyme replacement therapy actually have absolutely outstanding outcomes, and their lives have been transformed. But a small number of patients do have other complications that we need to be looking out for, and these are issues related to cancer risk. Some patients have ongoing issues with the bones, and then the risk of Parkinson's disease. And so the field has now evolved to a point where actually we are not just looking after the majority of the patients, but we are also starting to focus very seriously on what are the mechanisms here and how can we protect patients in the future going forward from these terrible complications. And so there is a connection between Gaucher disease and this cancer called multiple myeloma. The risk is high. It is almost greater than 20-fold compared to the general population. And there is a precursor of multiple myeloma. So in the clinic, we are able to identify individuals who may have that precursor, and it's called MGUS. And that is why this test called protein electrophoresis, or SPEP, has now become the standard of care, and it is one of the tests that's recommended by the ICGG registry. This is what SPEP looks like. This is normal, and when there is a patient who has a MGUS, there will be an abnormal spike, and that's what is reported in your set of results that you get back. As I said, majority of the patients don't have this spike, but the small number of patients who do have this spike, this is something that should be carefully monitored and get additional specialist opinion from hematologists who are experts in gammopathy and multiple myeloma. And so this spike is basically an antibody that is able to bind an antigen, the lipid antigen. And so, for example, if you have a flu vaccine, when you have your vaccine, you make antibodies that recognize the flu antigens. In the same way, there are studies that are currently in progress that are suggesting that the lipids are antigens, and they are recognized by these antibodies. And this is the pathway that leads to this B cells, which are the cells that manufacture the antibodies that leads to ultimately leads to development of gammopathy. And so we've recently published this study in the New England Journal of Medicine. There are differing views about this. So like any scientific research, there are controversies. And so this is very exciting. It is ultimately going to help patients, benefit patients, because controversies always move science forward. But this complicated slide that I put on basically shows that the Gaucher lipid is recognized by this clonal immunoglobulin that is underlies multiple myeloma, as well as this precursor called gammopathy. So the other question that is relevant to patients, the new generation of patients, is the future risk of Gaucher disease and Parkinson's. And Dr. Sidransky is here. Dr. Sidransky has been the pioneer in this field and has made seminal contribution. And this are two brothers who actually, I believe, have been evaluated by Dr. Sidransky's group. This is Ted, and this is Richard. They are both affected with Gaucher disease, but as you can see, Richard is severely affected with Parkinson's disease and Lewy body dementia, and he died almost within 10 years of first developing very mild tremor. I remember that day very vividly in the clinic. He was a musician and was playing guitar for a living. And he said, "I'm starting to get a bit clumsy." Within 10 years, tragically, Richard passed away from Lewy body dementia and Parkinson's disease. And so I mentioned Dr. Sidransky's work, and this is one of the really landmark papers in New England Journal from her group at the NIH that firmly established and settled the controversy about the link between Gaucher mutations and Parkinson's disease. But this association was really identified very early on, almost 20 years ago, and this is one such paper from my colleague, Dr. Ari Zimran, in Jerusalem, Israel. And so finally, I'm just going to mention a few things, topics that are starting to become into sharp focus in a variety of labs. And I think families that are affected really want to know, why is this disease so variable? And I think families often feel frustrated that we are not able to predict accurately if we make a diagnosis in a young person through family screening, how is Gaucher disease going to evolve? And one concept is that there are other genes, and variability in these other genes could contribute to development of how severe Gaucher disease is. And so just to emphasize how Gaucher disease can be so variable, these are two patients that I take care of. And they both have this N370S Gaucher disease. So they have two copies of this gene, a very ancient gene that arose actually around 10th century in Eastern Europe. And that this is the one that Brian mentioned, 1 in 10 person in Ashkenazi Jewish community are affected. And these are patients who live both in Connecticut, have similar environmental exposure, but look at what happened to this patient. This is someone who was born in early 1950s. By the age of 10, he was disabled. He had osteomyelitis, osteonecrosis of the right femur, and he was really limping and very limited during his childhood. He had a ruptured spleen, required emergency splenectomy at Yale New Haven Hospital, and then went on to develop a very rare and a dangerous kind of bone cancer when he was a young man at college and started enzyme replacement therapy, and he's now having VPRIV and doing extremely well. And now his current problems are that he has osteoporosis, he has old bone crisis, his vertebrae are very severely damaged, there is always a danger that his vertebrae are going to begin to collapse. A gentleman who has been severely impacted, although if you would look at him now, he's doing amazing things in his life, despite all of this. And look at this person. This is a patient who was born in 1970. She went through genetic screening at the time of pregnancy and was found to have two copies of N370S Gaucher disease, and she's completely normal. Her blood count is normal, her liver and spleen is normal, bone density is normal, her biomarkers are completely normal. So these are both Ashkenazi Jewish patients, and what is the difference between these two individuals? So there are efforts now currently underway in a variety of labs, and you're going to be hearing about this through the National Gaucher Foundation and the centers about how to embark on this work. But one of the things that builds on some of the concepts that have been advanced by Dr. Sidransky is that Gaucher disease is a continuum. But we think that possibly when you look in the whole spectrum, you might identify distinct subtypes of Gaucher disease. So this is a single gene disease, single enzyme deficiency, but there are a lot of different types and syndromes of Gaucher disease. And I think for optimal care of patients, it's very important for your doctor to recognize what you're dealing with and try and identify this early. And this is an important component of personalizing and individualizing care of patients. And so one technology that is going to be used is what is being offered by 23andMe. This is some of the readings that we get from what's called whole exome sequencing. And I know that many of you are familiar with 23andMe technology, which essentially looks for variants in other genes, more than 30,000 genes, and we applied this to one family that had Gaucher disease, and both children also developed cancer at an earlier age, and we found the cause of why Gaucher disease and this cancer kind of came together in this family. And I think there are going to be some ambitious initiatives to apply this kind of initiatives to look for rare variants in a rare disease. So this is one concept for this. But the other concept is that Gaucher disease is overall rare, and so it is more likely that you're gonna have a common variant that's common in the population. And this idea is going to be pursued by using this technique called genome-wide association study. And this is what's called a Manhattan plot, because the signals that we see look like the skyline of Manhattan. And you know, this is a very early study. It's already 4 years old. But I think you're going to see more of this kind of studies coming out, which is going to give us essential information on what are the genetic contributions for phenotypic diversity so that we can personalize care of patients in the clinic moving forward. And so finally, I don't want to forget are members of our community who are struggling with type 2 and type 3 Gaucher disease. This is a child under Dr. Bob Desnick at Mount Sinai, and this is a patient that I currently look after at Yale New Haven Hospital, and this is heartbreaking. We really must address this and develop therapies, and there are groups around the world, including Dr. Futterman, Dr. Greg Grabowski, who I'm pleased to see is here. His laboratory has made seminal contributions to understanding the mechanisms of type 2 and type 3 Gaucher disease. I think that we are now entering an era when there are likely to be major advances in treatment as well as management of this group of patients. This is a patient that I took care of with Dr. Grabowski and Dr. Kolodny. And this is a child with severe Gaucher disease, life-threatening. You know, I remember the day we saw this patient, we walked away from the bed feeling so sad because we thought this child was gonna die within a day. This is terminal, life-threatening Gaucher disease. This is after a few years of enzyme replacement therapy. This is a child with type 3 Gaucher disease. And so Dr. Grabowski and my colleagues in the ICGG registry, we've just published this paper of long-term outcomes in type 3 Gaucher disease, where it is a life-saving drug. But we need to develop therapies that prevent later development of neurological problems. And this is just one slide from that study showing dramatic outcome as far as the liver, spleen, and the blood count symptoms in these children with severe form of Gaucher disease. So there's new hope for patients who have neuropathic disease, and there is the next generation of Zydelga that is being developed that crosses the blood-brain barrier. And in the initial clinical studies in Gaucher mouse model between Genzyme and Dr. Grabowski's group have shown actually that the neuropathic disease can be significantly ameliorated. And this clinical trial will be starting soon. And so I'm very happy that we are looking at all of our community and not just patients with type 1 Gaucher disease. And so what we are striving for in 2017 is to try and personalize plan for monitoring and treatment of Gaucher disease, even though we don't have genetic markers yet, but we have a lot of other ways, you know, careful and diligent clinical exam, history taking, and using the right combination of testing, x-rays, biomarkers, and blood tests. So with that, I'm happy to take any questions if there are any. And I'm really pleased Dr. Grabowski and Dr. Sidransky are here because they can also contribute to address some of your questions. Any questions? Yes.
I have a lot of time.
Yeah.
I actually had to write them down so make sure that I can find them here. So first off, you showed a slide where you had 45% of ERT patients showing arthritis, but I had to look up, which is joint pain. My daughter's been on an ERT for 20 years, and yet she's got rotating joint pain. First it'll be in her knees, and then it'll go away, and then it'll be her elbows, and it'll be just random, and she's seen it at UCSF, you know, very good specialist for her whole life. I mean, is that typical? Is that what the 45% would evidence?
That's slide is really good.
Sorry, Ellen, sorry.
That slide was about ERT, it was about the
Right, so, you know, I think that the bone pain and the joint pains that was referred to, as Dr. Sidransky is saying, is the clinical trial with the oral medication. And when we do clinical trial, if a patient has a headache one time in the 9 months, that gets registered. And essentially, there was no major difference between patients who received Zydelga and patients who received placebo. I think we are going to get more data. I think in real world, generally this treatment has been well tolerated, but specifically addressing your question, which is joint pains a sign of Gaucher disease? So Gaucher disease generally involves the bone marrow, and so it's more bone pain, but some patients can suffer from bone crisis that affects the ends of the bone. And in that setting, if there's a secondary arthritis, it can lead to joint pains. And so the first question, if I have a patient coming to my clinic, I ask myself, what is the current status of bone disease? I would want to look at bone density. I would want to look at x-rays, the MRI to see how the bone marrow is looking like. And then to complement that, I think one should always look at biomarkers, chitotriosidase, and increasingly we use this lyso-GL1 in our clinic. And so symptoms such as what you describe have to be seen in the context of what is the current activity of the disease. Now, if you do all of that and find that your children, for example, everything is perfectly normal, then one should look for other reasons for why they have bone pain, joint pains.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
So my daughter, who's 25, lives in Israel, and she's the Gaucher patient. And she actually just got her first enzyme treatment earlier today. Yay. It took about a year and a half for them to approve it for her. She saw Dr. Zimran initially, and he took one look at her, laughed, and said, "You're not sick enough. And we're not going to treat you." She went through a whole bunch of testing. She went to see Dr. Rosenblum in Cedars-Sinai. He said you absolutely should be treated. And she's on about a half of the dose. They're willing to give her about half of the dose that Dr. Rosenblum recommended. And she's there for the near future. And my question is, how harmful, I mean, it's better, I guess, than nothing, but how harmful is it for her as a 25-year-old who's this much shy of osteopenia at this point to only be getting that half dose? They're hoping to come back to the States. Her fiance is Israeli, and they want to move here and go on the real full-on treatment. But how long, obviously we haven't seen her, but what is the implication of being on that much lower dose?
Thank you for asking that question. And the first thing I would say is Dr. Zimran has probably looked after more patients with Gaucher disease than anyone else in the world. And so he has made phenomenal contribution. And I think he understands Gaucher disease with an intimacy that very few people can match. So, if I had a family member with Gaucher disease, I would always feel very safe and confident in his management because he's right at the top in terms of expertise in Gaucher disease. As you point out, there are philosophical differences in how Gaucher disease is managed in different parts of the world. You mentioned Israel. I grew up and trained in England, and in England there's a very different philosophy of treatment. So is the case with Canada and Australia. And in many ways, I think United States is ahead of some of that debate. And so if you remember, we are in San Diego in the early days, there was a huge controversy about the dose and response, and it took almost two decades to settle it. And it was a study that was led by Dr. Grabowski looking at the dose response. And so, just as Gaucher disease affects individual patients differently, I believe, and what I have learned, is that response to enzyme replacement therapy is different. Some patients do respond exquisitely, some don't. And so you got to individualize the treatment. But I'm really happy to hear that your daughter is under care of Dr. Zimran.
Well, she's not anymore. She
okay.
had to go around him
right.
because he refused to authorize treatment for her.
Right.
So she went to someone else
okay.
And used the input from Dr. Rosenblum and all
right.
the work.
Okay. So I think that you, one thing that I tell my patients is be your strongest advocate. And I never get offended if one of my patients said, I'd like to have a second opinion. Indeed, it is not uncommon for me to reach out to my colleagues, senior colleagues, such as Dr. Grabowski, to say, I'm really stuck with this. I don't know, don't understand this. So just as patients are a community, we physicians are also a community, and we reach out. And I'm glad that your daughter is advocating for herself. Good.
Right. And we did a 23andMe and ran it through Prometheus on vacation while we were just sitting around, and it was like, well, what is this?
Right.
So I do think that the proliferation of this sort of popularization of this test is going to help a lot more people getting a diagnosis who didn't have a clue that they had the problem.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. So thank you for that question, Teresa. And you know, I would point you to the ICGG registry guidelines. And what we are recommending is that every patient at baseline should have bone density and MRI. MRI is something that should be done in adults. We do not recommend that children should undergo MRI, because it's traumatic for the child to go through the MRI machine. In addition, I think the quality of information we get in a growing child with a bone marrow is not so clear-cut as we would see in an adult. And so MRI in children is only performed when there is a specific question. If a child is having severe pains and waking up screaming and ending up in emergency room, that is a setting where we would definitely do an MRI. Or a patient has been diagnosed with growing pains that are repeated bone pains, and all the x-rays are normal, I think it's very important to do an MRI. The question is, how often should you do it? Now, there are two types of patients. There are types of patients who all the parameters after a few years of treatment are completely normal. And in these patients, I think you can afford not to have bone density or MRI for 3 years or even 4 years. And so there is some flexibility, and again, individualizing the recommendation. But it is not necessary in a patient who is stable and has achieved all the treatment goals to continue forever to have MRI and bone density. Teresa, can you explain what study is that? I'm not familiar. Greg, do you know? Thanks so much for raising that important question. Okay, so one of the things that we've learned as we've studied Gaucher disease more is that, you know, I talked about inflammation that's going on in the body, and one of the things that happens as a result of inflammation is scarring. And this is a feature that we've not underappreciated that, in fact. And so when there are nodules in the spleen, that is a sign of one of three possibilities. One is that there's a lot of scarring and you're seeing these nodules, or it could be just big collections of Gaucher cells. And we recognize this in a subset of patients, especially individuals who have had the biggest spleens to start off with. Unfortunately, these nodules don't go away in majority of the cases. But I would say you should not worry about these nodules because they don't generally cause any harm. Extremely rarely, there can be circumstances when there can be nodules that may be secondary to some kind of lymphoma. But you don't have to do any biopsies or any kind of special scans. If there is another problem that's contributing to the nodules, there's almost always a signal that can be picked up on the blood test.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
For patients, again, both my kids, 20 years, 22 years, consistently every 2 weeks.
Right.
Do they still run that
higher right.
risk? And if so, what might they do
right.
to have further tests or monitor?
Right. So we are really fortunate today that we have Dr. Ellen Sidransky here in the audience. So I'm going to have Dr. Sidransky make a few comments on this. Yes, Eileen.
So my question is, you talked about multiple myeloma, but how, what is the connection between other cancers? I've already had two forms of cancer. I had melanoma like 24 years ago. Luckily, it was very early stage and have had no problem, had surgery, no problem since. Now, recently here, I'm 80 years old, I just had breast cancer and had treatment for that, just finishing that. Because of this inflammatory nature of Gaucher's, is that why I'm more at risk for cancers?
Right. So this pathway where Gaucher disease impacts this lipid metabolism pathway has actually been a subject of very intense study by cancer researchers. And so this is a very important question. And my colleague, Dr. Neil Weinreb, teamed up with Dr. Robert Lee at University of Pittsburgh to really address this in the first generation of patients, because there was a big registry at University of Pittsburgh, and they did find increased risk of cancer in a paper that came out a couple of years ago. And so majority of the cancers that are present at increased risk are hematologic cancers, lymphoma, myeloma, and so on. But there were a couple others that have now seen to occur with increased frequency. One is liver cancer, according to researchers at Amsterdam Medical Center. And the other that Dr. Weinreb found is increased risk of kidney cancer. And indeed, just in the last 2 years, we have had two patients who just had regular MRI scan for their Gaucher evaluation, and they were found to have kidney cancer. So there may be, but we need some more solid scientific data. The important thing that I would point out is you don't want to leave this meeting thinking, as Nina mentioned, every time you come to this meeting, we are just giving you bad news. In fact, this should be empowering you. that we are looking at health outcomes, not in just the next 5 years, 20, 30, 40 years. So we are looking at the whole spectrum of risk to make sure that you have a healthy life in a long-term basis. So specifically coming back to the breast cancer, this has been examined by a variety of investigators. And one would think in the Ashkenazi Jewish community, with the common BRCA mutation, and you might have, and that has not turned out to be the case. That's interesting. Colorectal cancer is not increased in Gaucher disease. You mentioned melanoma, and that has not been noted in other studies, but in our study from Yale and NYU, we did find a mild signal. So the important thing, again, I emphasize very, very clearly that these are issues that impact only in the minority of patients, only in 4 or 5%. And hence, I would say, you should feel empowered that we are even looking at those risks so that we keep your loved ones healthy for their lives, yeah? Yes, Gary. Yeah, Gary, that's a great question. There is a revised ICGG guidelines in the works at the moment. And again, I emphasize having MGUS and multiple myeloma is not an issue in younger patients, in children, young adults. This is something that evolves in individuals over the age of 40. And particularly in our series that we looked at, every one of our myeloma patients were older than 60 years old. And so, Gary, directly in answer to your question, we don't do protein electrophoresis in our pediatric patients or young, but certainly from age of 40, thereabouts. So we do an SPAP in all adults as a baseline, and vast majority of them are negative. And then we don't continue to monitor every year until they are into their 40s. But we are actually discussing what the revised recommendations are going to look like. So, Michelle, thanks for that question. Actually, somebody asked me that yesterday. There is no connection between lupus and Gaucher disease. I think there might have been some confusion caused because, as I pointed out, Gaucher disease is a disease that activates the immune system, and in the process, you make all kind of antibodies, including anti-nuclear antibody and so on. And so the fact that you have these antibodies does not mean that you have a second disease on top of that, lupus. There's absolutely no evidence that there is an association between lupus and Gaucher disease. Hi, Gabriela. I think you're calling in probably from Colombia or Argentina. So it's really nice that people are all over the world are tuning in. I know Gabriela very well. So Gabriela, the answer to your question is really, it's a very individualized recommendation, and it should be really in the province of your primary treating physician. It's not my place to start making recommendations that can apply to somebody who lives in Latin America. So my advice to you, Gabriela, is please discuss with the person who is following your Gaucher disease at the moment. And certainly, if you want, if you ever come to the United States, there are several centers of excellence that you can certainly come by for an evaluation with that specific question if you're interested.
Thank you.
Dr. Grabowski, can I ask you to make a comment? Yeah.
I'd just like to respond to your comment about coming to hear bad news. Okay. And yes and no. Think about who would be in this room if we didn't have enzyme therapy. Okay. I would bet Brian would not be here.
Yeah.
I would bet a number of younger people over the years would not be here. Remember that a cancer doctor looks at a treatment and a cure that means you're disease-free at 5 years. Doesn't look at 20 years. Now they are. And there are other things that are happening to these people that are developing secondary cancers and so forth that may be related to their therapy. Here, I should resurrect the slide I used to have that said Gaucher disease patients have the right to get any other disease. And you do. And it's very important then to stay in touch with the experts in this field who are asking the question of, is it related? We have to treat what you may get, but is it related? Some of the things are going to be yes, and some of the things are going to be no. We're in uncharted territory. After 25 or so years of therapy for this disease, we've accomplished an enormous amount to your benefits, all due to Roscoe. But we're in uncharted territory because we don't know what will happen. I'll give you a good example, a totally different disease, one that I've been working on for a long time. This disease had an average age of death of 3.5 months. And it's a lysosomal disease. With treatment, there are several children now who are 6 and 7 years old who are normal. I have no idea what's going to happen to them when they're 25. I don't know. We have a treatment, not a cure. And so this interaction with the experts in the Gaucher community and the benefits that derive have to be looked at. If you look at the original population that came into the enzyme therapy trials and studies, they were very different than the patients we're seeing now. Yes, there are still a few type 1 patients who have very severe disease that come in late therapy. Many of them now are much younger. We're preventing disease, as you heard from Dr. Mistry, preventing manifestations. It's also naive on our part to think that monotherapy is enough. Is treatment just with enzymes sufficient? If you have articular pains, or if you have arthritis kinds of pains, or if you develop osteoporosis, are there additional drugs to use to treat those manifestations in addition to enzyme therapy? So there are a lot of undefined things here. The overall benefit is enormously good. And with the development of Serdelgo, which is amazing, in its effects, we may even see even better results in certain areas. So the positive part of this is we're on this journey together, and we're here because you're better, and people with Gaucher disease are better, and these unanswered questions keep coming up. Now, and I'll say my last political thing of the night. You have to understand there are no alternative facts. There are facts that are scientifically based, and people can look at them differently, and there are interpretations that you have, but there are no alternative facts. And this is really important to keep in mind as we move through this area. Some people, the problems, the discussions we've had with our Zimron and dosage and so forth. Ernie Beutler and I wrote a chapter on Gaucher disease, a metabolic base of inherited disease. We were at each other's throats for most of the time. My complaint was not that low dose therapy wouldn't work. He was saying it's the only dose. It's not. Each person has an individual disease that has to be monitored by people who really care about you. And see how your response is to that dose that you're getting. The MRI question before about how often you do this. If you change a dose, what do we have to measure the don't get at the kind of biomarkers that we need. So we're on this road, and if you're in the hands of people who care about you, and my model when I was at Cincinnati Children's and at Mount Sinai was, you need a physician who cares about you. I don't care if your primary physician or the person you go to primarily is a Gaucher expert, as long as they pick up the phone and call. I called Boitler all the time to ask, and he would call me, even though we disagreed about all kinds of things. But this is how you improve care. So I think overall, this has been an enormously positive experience for almost everybody in this field. This child that Graham showed you, that was dying, the decision that that committee that I'm on with Graham and Dr. Kolodny had to make, and think about this in terms of our health environment. Did that child warrant therapy? Because once we made the decision to treat that child was on therapy for life, okay? Because of the way this works. And the results were amazing. What did we learn? We learned what is possible to treat. And it's pretty incredible. And so this is what you're all involved with. And this is so important, that this collaboration between your physicians and yourselves, and other healthcare personnel who really care about you and keep moving forward.
You know, I want to just thank Dr. Grabowski, because what you're hearing is more than four decades of dedicated research. Dr. Grabowski has really been a pioneer in the field. And as he was talking, you know, really sharing this extraordinary insights, something just ran across my mind, which is that in the rare disease community, you know, in many ways, societally, these expectations are set low. So I'm a liver specialist in addition to having an interest in Gaucher disease. If somebody needs a liver transplant, you don't go to your local hospital. In order for a center to do a liver transplant, you have to meet certain benchmarks that qualify you by the federal government that you can offer liver transplant as a therapy. Here is Gaucher disease, which is such a complex disease, high-tech, expensive, and much more expensive and complex than individuals who have liver transplant. And yet the concept of center of excellence, or reaching out to develop a care plan between your primary care physician and the center of excellence, is not something that has really evolved very well. And I think that's where Brian's vision is so important for the rare disease community. And for cystic fibrosis, it's very highly evolved, but for lysosomal diseases, it doesn't exist. And as with everything else, Gaucher is taking the lead. Right, so fatigue is an important question, I think, because it can impact hugely. I have had patients who have experienced fatigue from Gaucher disease, that they would drive their shopping into the driveway and not have the energy to go. So this is a real problem. This is not in the head. Sad thing is that many patients are just stigmatized, that they are kind of malingering, or there is a psychological basis to this. So the question about what might be the mechanism of fatigue is a very interesting one. We talked about all this inflammation in Gaucher disease, and that leads to what we call cytokine storm. And these cytokines make you feel very tired. And I think what Andrea is asking is, I'm on enzyme replacement therapy, why am I still fatigued? And again, I think it would be a mistake for me to stand here and, on the basis of limited information, start making sweeping recommendation. But if a patient comes to my clinic and complains of fatigue, the first question I ask is, yes, the patient is on enzyme replacement therapy. Are they having the expected optimal response? Or how much is the disease activity? this is where these biomarkers are going to become very important. And I think if patient has had a good response to enzyme therapy, but are continuing to have high levels of these biomarkers and lipids that tell you that the disease is still active, then one might want to look at why is their response, they're having residual activity. And the reasons for this can be many. It could be that they've developed antibodies to the enzyme. It's very important to check for that. Or they are not on the right dose, as Dr. Grabowski pointed out, that every patient is an individual. Some patients need low dose and they do fine, some do need higher dose. And then finally, is there a lot of scarring in the body, fibrosis, that is affecting the delivery of the enzyme? So if you've got Gaucher bone marrow or the spleen that is full of Gaucher disease but is surrounded by scar tissue that the enzyme cannot get through, then that would be a factor. So my answer to this, your question, is that there are complex issues that need to be addressed, and I would encourage you to talk to your treating physician. Eileen? Right, right. That's a great point. Thank you.
Hi. When you were mentioning about the possibility of doing the whole, is it exome sequencing, is it more helpful if both parents get the same sequencing also to learn about?
Yeah. That really is a great question. I'd love to have Dr. Sidransky and Dr. Grabowski comment on this. So the idea of doing whole exome sequencing is to look for rare variants. So statistically, having a rare disease and having another rare variant is very, very low, okay? So I am not too sure with time, although a number of us are looking into this now, whether that is going to be a very fruitful line of investigation. Okay, so I think that we may get more common variants that are present in easily 20% of us here. That, when you combine with Gaucher disease, then it throws up particular phenotypes. But you are absolutely right. When we look at whole exome sequencing and we find a rare variant, an important question is it what we call de novo mutation? Did it arise for the first time in your child, and neither the parent is responsible for that? That's an important scientific question. And in some circumstances, it's very important for management of that family, because if you have other children, the question arises, what is their genetic risk? Yeah. So generally, we are not offering whole exome sequencing. As a clinical service in Gaucher, it's all research, but under very specific circumstances, this has been conducted, and I showed you an example of a family with two children with Gaucher disease who also had really bad type of cancer.
Able to continually be treated,
This is such an important question, and I'm going to have Amy and Brian weigh in there before I say anything.
Should be able to be able to treat Gaucher in the United States with almost no out-of-pocket cost, other than in some strange circumstances. And whenever we see a gap, we're trying to continue to close that gap. But we're on high alert on that issue. You know, we can't weigh in on the medical side. That's why we rely on these specialists. And when it comes to making sure that folks get access to treatment, that's sort of number one on our radar.
Thank you. So one more from our friend Tony. Asking, are Gaucher carriers symptomatic? Meaning that she is in the process of trying to figure out if she is either a carrier or has the disease and has many symptoms of the disease and is wondering, and Michelle Snyder is also wondering the same question, because she's saying that she has the disease and her daughter is a carrier, often complains of things that she did as a child. So they want to know if being carriers can be symptomatic.
No, being carriers does not lead to any Gaucher symptoms. You have to have two copies of Gaucher genes to develop Gaucher disease. So being a carrier does not put you any risk of developing any symptoms related to Gaucher disease. I think there's one proviso to that, and if I may have Dr. Sidransky comment on this, because this is an important question for families affected with this. Ellen, could you please help us with this?
Yes.